Hello, everybody. Hi. Nice to see you guys. Have a seat if you're not seated. All right, so I have to explain what you didn't see the ads because I'm airhead and I forgot to turn them on. So we have Dr. McGee, we have like Dr. Boger, the ENT, we have all kinds of people. Gene Omens, what else? Anyways, next time you come, you can see the ads. Sorry about that. Sorry. I just told the world I messed up too. All right. So who's here for the first time? A few people. We have some people from Lakeland, don't we? Who's from Lakeland? All right. Excellent. So, well, welcome. This is our living room. And my lovely wife and I, we live here. This is our house. And my son Charles, too. Actually, peux-tu allumer les spots, s'il te plaît? Le plus haut à gauche. So, actually, Charles made that sign a few months ago. I like to point that out because people don't know. Yeah? All right, so, peux-tu aussi, là, je peux le faire ici, par exemple. Yeah, we can make this a little bit more dramatic. Especially for the artwork, you know, it deserves to be lit properly. So, so let me start with the housekeeping a little bit. We have three bathrooms, so please, you know, if there's a line there, you can. There's two more. You can just climb up the stairs and get the other bathroom. They're all stacked on top of each other. I'm gonna slow down a little bit. I can barely speak English in the best of times. So, in case of emergency, please use that exit or the entrance that you used to come in, or you can use the west side exit. If you're on top or anywhere on the balconies, don't try to use any door back there. They're either bedrooms or places that don't go anywhere, and you'd have to jump like a long way to get down. So you don't want to do that. Anyways, it should be locked. So they're all should be locked, but we could forget whatever. Anything else I need to say about? Oh yeah, phones. Oh yeah, 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 yeah. Some of that stuff is particularly quiet today. Some of it. So you want to make sure that you silence your phone. I know I did, but I'm checking, double, triple checking. Okay, it's definitely up. And you can also kill the flash. You're welcome to take pictures, but you don't need a flash. So as you can see, right, I'm pretty clear. You can try it and share your pictures on Instagram, hashtag Timuqua Arts. You can check in on Facebook, hey, I'm here, or Instagram or anywhere. It's fine with us. It's all good, it helps us actually. So, glasses, okay. So if you have a wine glass, if you're lucky enough to like wine and you happen to have a wine glass in your hand, just keep it for the whole night. And when you're done, before you leave, just bring it in the kitchen so that I don't have to go hunting for wine glasses. I am a pacifist. I like wine glasses. I don't like to hunt for them. And I'm also relatively lazy. I don't like to clean up. I clean up because I have to, you know. But I'm the janitor here, so I like to have as little to do as possible. And your kitchen trash, please, goes in the bins in the lobby, not in the bathroom trash. Thank you. Also, the schedule coming up. We have Saturday at 2:30 p.m. a Latin percussion workshop with Dimas Sanchez, who's David Sanchez's brother, and who's a very well-known percussionist from Puerto Rico originally. And Marty Morel, who's Cuban. People don't know that he's Cuban, but he's Cuban. At least his parents were. And of course, he played drums with Bill Evans for the last 7 years of Bill Evans' life. And we all know that, but we don't realize that he's also a Latin music specialist. So both of them are going to be giving that workshop Saturday here. It's $5 for adults, free for kids. And it's an interactive, immersive workshop, and you don't need to have any experience or instruments. We have experience, yes, but we have instruments here, and so you can use our stuff, no problem. So, and then Sunday night, Eminem, Marty and Michiko, the sextet is Eminem, is the Latin jazz sextet in which Marty actually plays vibes, and he's a fabulous vibes player. If you did not know that, actually, he's a very good pianist. A lot of people don't know that, but he plays very well. I think that's with La Lucha, right? I think it's Eminem and La Lucha, if I'm correct. And Jeff Rupert on tenor, usually. So, yeah. Let's talk about Laura's work, the artwork, yes? Laura Ricci. So, she is not going to come on stage and talk to you, but she's going to come on stage and paint for you, which is even better. But what is amazing to me is that, what?
Nothing.
I'm used to getting interrupted by my wife. It's just, we do it all the time. So anyways, I am amazed at the prices at which these are set. So like $250, $200. This one is not for sale. That was a commission and it's spoken for. But the other three are for sale. And you did not bring prints, right? Who needs prints at $200 for an original? So buy some art. Like the holidays are coming up. So, you know, $250 for those, right? $250 for those?
$450
and $250 for this one. Anyways, talk to her. She keeps all the money. You need to go through her to buy them anyways. So, and to find out how she paints, why she paints, and how are you going to find out, but why is always cool and stories and things. That's why we come to this kind of place, right? You don't want to go to this gigantic place. You don't. Anyways, I'm talking too much. I'm talking too much. Okay, the last thing on our plate, on our schedule before the end of the year is December 21st, which is pretty cool, and the tickets are going fast. We have still a few left, but not very many.
It will sell out.
This is basically four Korean women playing traditional Korean holiday music, which will be very, very cool. We have like two opera singers, a cellist and a pianist. So it's really cool. Four classical musicians from Korea, but they decided to kind of give you the music that that they grew up with. We have membership forms. What's the CD?
What's and they have price on that ticket at event, right?
Yes, if you remember, like for $100, $120, $100, it's too cheap. You get like a membership, and every ticketed event, which is usually $20, you get half off. And then you get like specialized all kinds of benefits. But let's welcome, what's that CD? CD from who? Mine? That's my CD. Yeah, that's my CD. That's a Baroque opera CD. She's very eager to sell it, and so am I. I produced it in 2004. I still haven't, you know, broken even yet at all. Not even close. I have three of them, and there's none of them are close to breaking even. So, which is fine. It's fine.
It was
fun to make. And but let's welcome our executive director, Chris Bell. He's going to talk to you about very important stuff.
Hello. Thanks very much, everyone, for being here. I greatly appreciate your presence on this evening. I'll keep it very short, but I just wanted to give everyone an update and some insights into like where you are and where this whole thing is going. How did this come about? Some of you may know that the first time I was here, because I've told this story many times, was in 2008, and I came as a young classical musician myself, playing classical guitar. I was a grad student, and my department said, okay, we're going to go do a house concert. I'm like, okay. I played in a punk band when I was 13. I know what this house concert thing is all about. And I showed up, I stepped through those doors, and it completely changed my life. And so I've been involved here for 10 years, first as a volunteer, then this, the foundation that Benoit Nolan started was the fiscal sponsor of a contemporary classical music series that I supported and started. So then I was involved in that way, and now for the last 2.5 years I've been the executive director. And it takes a team to make this thing happen, and the biggest part of our team is our members. So we have some board members here. We have a fantastic board that's been helping us to achieve our financial goals and make sure that this thing can keep happening. So I just wanted to acknowledge our board member, Jason Schaller, is here. And board member Wendy Wallenberg is here. And we also have our group of members. You've already heard us 2 or 3 times mention our membership program. We started a goal on November 16th to sign up 50 new members. We've gotten 15. And we're hoping for 35 more by the end of the year. So if you want to make my night and keep this thing going because you think it's special, then please come and see us about a membership. $50,000 for us to raise this month. It's a big goal. It's a big ambitious goal, but it means that you get to have incredible world-class performances in a space unlike any other. So without further ado, I will exit the stage. Thanks for being here. Greatly appreciate it.
We're done with that. So, you ready to go? Yes. So let's welcome Laura Ricci. These two very, very amazing young musicians, Robert and Giancarlo, who together are Escape Velocity. Thank you.
Thank you. being here. It's really awesome to be here. I'm Robert Flights. This is Giancarlo Latta, and we're also so happy to be joined on stage by Laura Ricci. And I love this is so it's really cool to see this happen.
I can't wait either.
So the piece we just played is a piece called Music for 247 Strings, because that's the amount of strings that a violin and a piano have combined. Except not all pianos have the same number of strings, so it's a little bit of controversy, but basically by a composer named Judith Weir, who is a British composer. She's actually the master of the Queen's music, I believe. Something like that. And she, basically this piece follows us as we start completely in unison, kind of clash with each other, and then come back together. And that's a little bit of the whole arc of this program, starting with a sort of playful and kind of music where we're sort of working together, and then moving into a world where we're sort of in opposition with each other, and then going back and symmetry on both sides. So to tell you a little bit about the next piece.
Yeah, I'm Giancarlo. Great to be here. Great to be sharing the stage with two collaborators instead of just one. Not that Robert's not plenty. The next piece we're gonna play is by a friend of ours. This is actually the world premiere. He wrote it for us earlier this year. His name's Theo Chandler, and he did his undergraduate studies at Oberlin and then went to Juilliard, which is where Robert knew him, and now goes to Rice University where he's getting his doctorate, and that's where I met him. And this piece is called Reflected Arcs, which is also, as Robert alluded to, the title of our program. And I'll just read what he wrote because I think it describes the piece very, very succinctly and very well. So this is Theo Chandler's program note. Reflected Arcs is my first piece to make a thorough exploration of musical symmetry and reflections. Much like seeing our reversed reflection in a mirror, the reflections in the piece are instances where material is repeated, but one significant parameter is flipped. For example, the fourth movement is the same material as the second, but the register has been flipped from high to low. The fifth and first movements are the same, but the instrumental relationships have been flipped. So the entire piece forms, because of this, a loose palindrome, but the second half is marked by a flipping of the violin's dynamic range as controlled by a practice mute, which is this contraption that I put on my violin. So it's the first and fifth movements, you will hopefully notice some connections, second and fourth, and then the middle is titled Axis of Reflection, and it in itself sort of mirrors its first half and second half, and it has this, you'll know when it's the middle of the piece because I will take this off. So keep an eye out for that. So this is the first public performance of Reflected Arcs by Theo Chandler.
Thank you.
Thank you.
next piece is the Violin Sonata by Ruth Crawford, also sometimes referred to as Ruth Crawford Seeker, because she was married to Charles Seeger, I believe, who is Pete Seeger's father. Thank you. but she had her own fairly prolific compositional career, and she doesn't have a ton of music, but in the past few years, it seems there's been a renewed interest, especially in her string quartet, which has gotten a lot of performances, it seems like, just in the past couple of years. So this is her violin sonata, which is from 1926, I believe. And it's in four movements. It's on the page, it's pretty standard as far as sonatas of the era go. But it's really got a modernist but also quasi-romantic sensibility that I think is pretty unique. Do you have anything you want to say about it other than that?
No, I think that that sums it up really well. It has the kind of, it has the angst of and the edginess that make it sound a lot newer than 1926, which is kind of amazing.
Yeah.
And yet also the like very intense emotion of music that was being written at the end of the 19th century.
Yeah.
And a little fun second movement.
Yeah.
Just to keep it fresh. more pieces that gradually make their way back into the light, perhaps. And the should explain the name Escape Velocity, which is our duo name. Some of you might know the concept. It's the amount of force it takes for a object to escape another orbit. So, like a object in the orbit of the Earth or the Moon or something, how much it would need to escape that orbit. And we think of the music that we play, a lot of which is written in the past 100 years, using the violin and the piano as kind of this massive body that the violin is sometimes in its orbit, sometimes they're against each other, and sometimes the violin's trying to escape. And this short piece is by a friend of ours, Jessica Mays, who's a really fantastic composer. She studied at McGill. She's from Colorado, but now she lives in New York. And it's a great illustration of that exact phenomenon between us as we kind of bounce material back and forth off of each other in this sort of swinging gesture until it kind of just can't hold on any longer. So here's Duo.
Thank you.
Was a British composer who actually passed away earlier this year. Sort of one of the towering giants of the second half of this past century in terms of concert music. This is a piece called Autumnal, and it's one of his earlier pieces, Opus 14. He actually had a fairly small output throughout his life. He was known for often missing deadlines because he was so painstakingly revising up until the day of premieres, and he sort of got a bad reputation for it, but especially this year, as a lot of his music has been played, people are really appreciating the sort of crystalline quality of that workmanship. So this piece, Autumnal, was written in the mid-1970s as a memoriam to Benjamin Britten, who I'm not sure if he was Nussin's teacher, but definitely would have been an influence as a fellow Brit, and you know, growing up in that sort of environment in London. So this piece is in two short movements. The first one is called Nocturne, the second one is called Serenade, and the first sort of develops slowly. It gets busier and busier, and then the second half of it involves these sort of free cadenza-like back and forth sections between the violin and piano. And then it goes directly into the second movement, which starts with violin pizzicato, which he marks quasi-mandolin. So this sort of nocturnal serenade, maybe a
under the window
serenading.
The balcony.
So this is Oliver Nussin's Autumnal. It's in two short movements. Actually, I forgot to mention this, but this is the first piece that Robert and I played together.
Oh, nice.
And,
yeah.
So you'll actually illustrates, it's his fourth violin sonata, and it illustrates, it's called Children's Day at the Camp Meeting. It has a whole story, but basically it's about a bunch of kids who go to summer camp in the first movement, and the first movement's just them going in to camp. And then the second movement is a bit, it's the longest movement of the piece. It's they're learning songs. This is the Jesus Loves Me. It's marked Con Sluggo Rocco at one point, which is a moment in the middle of the movement where you'll hear kids throwing rocks into the river, but then they're sort of herded back together, and they keep singing. And then the final movement is sort of just a celebratory group song at the end of the day. So, yeah, thanks again for having us, and here's Charles Ives' fourth violin sonata. And also, thank you so much to Laura for being up here with us.
That's awesome.
It's such a, yeah, it looks amazing.
Thank you. Thank you.
set.